Welcome to another presentation about the Carolina Bays. The Carolina Bays have a mathematically elliptical geometry, and since ellipses are conic sections, this implies that the bays originated as inclined conical cavities. This episode describes some of the comments that I get about my videos and how the azimuths or headings are calculated by fitting ellipses to the Carolina Bays using the least squares method. The headings of the elliptical basins found on the Atlantic coastal plain, Nebraska, and other locations of the United States converge by the Great Lakes. This image shows the great circle trajectories for the basins that I have personally investigated. The basins do not have any evidence of extraterrestrial material, so they were not made by meteorite impacts. The best explanation for the elliptical geometry of these basins is that they formed as penetration funnels by secondary impacts of glacier ice pieces ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet during the Ice Age. Experiments confirm that oblique impacts by ice projectiles on a viscous target produce inclined conical cavities that look elliptical when viewed from above, and that viscous relaxation reduces the depth of the cavities to produce shallow elliptical basins. There are some persistent and deeply rooted myths in the geological community about the effect of an extraterrestrial impact on an ice sheet, and about how the elliptical basins originated. A viewer of one of my videos left a comment with two misconceptions. He said, "An impact on the ice sheet would have vaporized the ice. It would have vaporized rock. Carolina Bays are eroded remains of epiglacial thermokarst lakes." The idea that an impact on an ice sheet just melts or vaporizes the ice is very common, but it is 98% wrong. Professor Schultz from Brown University has shown that high-speed impacts on an ice sheet break up the ice sheet and the ice pieces are ejected in ballistic trajectories from the impact site. Most of the kinetic energy of the projectile is transferred as kinetic energy to the ice pieces created by the shock of the impact, and only a small portion of the energy gets converted to heat to melt the ice and vaporize the meltwater. The statement that the Carolina Bays are the eroded remains of epiglacial thermokarst lakes is another misconception. It is based on the thermokarst fallacy, which proposes that the Carolina Bays are identical to thermokarst lakes that form in permafrost, and therefore the presence of Carolina Bays implies the presence of permafrost at an earlier time. Geologist Christopher Suisi promoted the thermokarst fallacy in one of his publications, where he stated that the presence of Carolina Bays in North and South Carolina implies that these states had permafrost at one time, even though two different publications say that the southern limit of continuous permafrost during the last glacial maximum was located in central or northern Virginia. The thermokarst fallacy has made its way into Wikipedia, where the Carolina Bays are described as relict thermokarst lakes. Several professional geologists have rebuked Swiss's thermokarst fallacy. A paper published in 2021 by London and Trembanis describes several geological features that distinguish Carolina Bays from thermokarst lakes. Quote, "Carolina Bays have also been compared to thermokarst or thaw lakes in the Arctic due to their similar appearance, oriented elliptical depressions. The maximum relief of thaw lakes, rim apex to bottom of basin, often exceeds 10 meters, much greater than the maximum relief results reported for Carolina Bays. Again, if the Carolina Bay basin's deposits are removed, their maximum reliefs are only increased by a few meters, still much less than that of the typical thaw lake. The presence of permafrost, a prerequisite for thermokarst formation as far south as the coastal plain of Georgia, seems unlikely even during prior glacial maximums. It also is not supported by proxies, nor is it supported by modeled predictions of past permafrost extents." End quote. In my presentations, I always emphasize the elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays and Nebraska rainwater basins. I usually plot points along the perimeter of the basin and fit the ellipse by the least squares method. A good fit confirms the elliptical geometry of the basin, and it affirms its likely origin as an inclined conical cavity because ellipses are conic sections. Sometimes I'm criticized for my emphasis on the elliptical geometry. One person said, "Only the rainwater basins that you chose to show are mathematically elliptical. There are many others that aren't, but are more circular. Natural lakes in unconsolidated sediment tend to round out due to bank erosion. Add to that the dominant wind direction was from the north-northwest during the late Pleistocene, and you can get a more ellipsoid shape. The most consistent rims found on the southeast side because they are playa lakes that had sand blown out of them." Anybody who has studied the LIDAR images can easily see that the Alaskan thermokarst lakes have very rough irregular borders compared to the smooth elliptical features of the Carolina Bays. They just don't look the same. You don't need to be a geologist to understand that the Carolina Bays were not created by the same physical mechanisms as the lakes in Alaska. In 1977, Raymond Kocharovsky conducted an experiment where he carved a circular indentation on a sand tray that he filled with water to represent the model lake, and then he set a fan to blow over the water. He was probably not getting the results that he wanted, so he changed the fan to blow in opposite directions as indicated by the arrows every 15 minutes for 4 hours. This periodic reversal of wind direction by 180 degrees does not happen in nature, and certainly not in the Atlantic coastal plain where the Carolina Bays are found. Kocharovsky describes his experiment as changing the model lake from circular to elliptical, but what he obtained looked more like a bloated American football than an ellipse. Kocharovsky concluded that wind and water mechanisms could have formed the Carolina Bays, and many scientists support his hypothesis in spite of the unrealistic experimental wind conditions and the difference in the resulting shape. Thus far, there is no experimental evidence that wind and water mechanisms can consistently produce mathematically elliptical features like the Carolina Bays. The comments in my YouTube videos sometimes contain questions like this one. Antonio, I'm looking at the screen at 221 where you show the direction it came from. I'm not sure how you calculate that angle, but it is clearly inaccurate. Just looking at the bay visually, it is clear that the angle should point more to the west, possibly toward the other impact site, not the Saginaw Bay site. Please either recalculate that or show us how you got that result, because visual inspection does not agree with your video image. The subscriber was referring to this image about a Carolina Bay in East Texas that had an azimuth of 220.8 degrees. I replied, the calculation of the azimuth 220.7 comes directly from the Python program that fits the ellipse to the points. You can verify it on your computer monitor or by printing the image on the screen as follows. An azimuth of 180 would be straight down. We need to add 40 degrees to get 220, so we hold the protractor with the straight edge oriented vertically and use a ruler to go through the 40 degree mark in the center of the protractor. The edge of the ruler marks the 220 degree azimuth. When the image is oriented with the north to the top, we can easily check the azimuth by using a protractor and a ruler. The subscriber replied, "Thanks for explaining how the azimuth is calculated. I still disagree with the azimuth that would come out of that image. Perhaps it is due to the points chosen for the ellipse, but you can clearly see that the southwest part of the ellipse is not the farthest from the center. The farthest point from the center on the southwest side is more southeast from the point. The same goes for the northeast point. The line should be more to the northwest. I suggest choosing a slightly different set of points and see if a different azimuth comes out. Like I said, if you visually look at the azimuth of the bay, it is clear that the azimuth is counterclockwise from the one your program calculates. It looks like the points you choose to represent the edge are higher on the rim on the east side than on the west side. Also, the single point on the northernmost side is off due to the eroded nature there. I appreciate comments that make me think. The suggestion of using a different set of points seemed reasonable as a way of calibrating the accuracy of the azimuth calculation. I decided to test the idea of using several sets of points for a well-preserved Carolina Bay near Bowmore, North Carolina. The bay has a road along the northeast rim and a drainage ditch on the south. The center of the bay is completely covered with rows of trees. The rectangular feature in the LiDAR image is a set of 8 large barns. I first tried fitting an ellipse through only 5 points, which is the minimum number of points that defines an ellipse. The Python program calculated a major axis of 912.3 meters and an azimuth of 135.6 degrees. With 10 points, the major axis was 4 meters longer and the azimuth was 1 degree smaller. 16 points increased the length of the ellipse by 11 meters, but the azimuth remained about the same. In order to mark 24 points, I had to avoid the drainage ditch and the place where the road crossed the rim of the bay. With 24 points, the length of the ellipse increased by 6 meters, but the azimuth reverted to the value using 5 points. I then tried to estimate the azimuth of the Carolina Bay manually, but it was not easy. You cannot really tell where the center of the bay is, and it is difficult to know whether you are bisecting the elliptical feature properly. Using the Google Earth ruler tool, I measured a major axis of 929.6 meters and an azimuth of 137.4 degrees. The value of the azimuth was consistent when fitting an ellipse by the least squares method. This means that the orientation of the ellipse remained fairly constant regardless of the number of points. The azimuth of 137.4 degrees estimated manually has an error of 1.8%. The length of the major axis became more accurate as the number of points increased. The average of the major axis calculated with 16 and 24 points is close to what was measured by the manual method. I wanted to know what effect the 1.8% error in the angle would have on the calculation of the convergence point of the base. This image shows the projections of an azimuth of 135 degrees calculated by the program and 137.4 degrees estimated manually. The distance between the endpoints is 58 kilometers at a distance of about 1,280 kilometers. Taking the rotation of the Earth into consideration, these trajectories lead to Lake Michigan, which is the convergence point of many Carolina bays. The Younger Dryas impact hypothesis, published in 2007 by Richard Firestone and 25 co-authors, proposed that one or more extraterrestrial impacts or airbursts by the Great Lakes caused a megafaunal extinction and triggered the Younger Dryas cooling event. Several papers deny that an extraterrestrial impact happened 12,900 years ago, and the critics keep emphasizing that no impact crater and no shocked minerals have ever been found for the purported event. These papers call the Carolina Bays kettle ponds and dismiss them as structures formed by wind and water without even mentioning their elliptical morphology. The Nebraska rainwater basins are not mentioned at all. The 2011 paper by Painter and six co-authors says the following when discussing the Carolina Bays, quote, "Furthermore, the axes of the elliptical base do not truly converge near the Great Lakes, but rather vary in orientation both locally and regionally." End quote. Two references are cited. The 1942 book by Johnson and the 1970 paper by Thumb were published more than 50 years ago at a time when LIDAR imaging was not available and the Nebraska rainwater basins had not been discovered yet. The paper published in 2023 by Holiday and 11 co-authors just repeats what the 2011 paper by Painter said. The major axes of the elliptical base do not truly point to the Great Lakes and they vary in orientation both locally and regionally. The same two outdated references are used. The book by Johnson was published 81 years ago, where he mentions that he had to work with aerial photographs stored in survey offices. It is regrettable that this paper published by Holiday in 2023 relies on sources that were published before LIDAR imaging was widely used. LIDAR has made it possible to debunk the statements that the orientation of the Carolina Bays do not truly point toward the Great Lakes. Just look at this image and the intersection of the lines. If the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska basins are not pointing toward the Great Lakes, where are they pointing? It seems that there is a widespread conspiracy by many geologists to reject the impact hypothesis without examining the evidence using modern tools like Google Earth and LIDAR images. I have a great hope that when open-minded geologists start examining the LIDAR images and testing the ellipticity of the Carolina Bays by the least squares method, they will be convinced that the Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities because ellipses are conic sections. This would be the first step in getting rid of the myths that have held back the study of the base for more than 80 years. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. There's a link to the LIDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.